How we doing? Welcome back.
Hit the ground. It's been big too much. Just to cover it up now.
Okay. You hear it? The first president of the United States, George Washington. He was, the Constitution is ratified, and he will take office. And I'll draw you just a picture of the first few presidents. He goes from 1789 to 1796. 96 to 1800. This is Adams. This is GW. GW has two terms. Adams is one term. There's one term, one term. Jefferson comes next. He's two terms. Thomas Jefferson. He leaves office in 1808. And then we got James Madison. He gets two terms, and he leaves office in 1816. We got, by the way, you got the War of 1812 right here in the middle. That's a fun fact. And then 1816, we get two terms for James Monroe. And he goes to 1824, in 1824 to 28. That's one term, sorry. That's John Quincy Adams. And he loses in the 1828 election. And two terms for Andrew Jackson right here. Very important. So we got the first administrations. And what we're going to talk about with this PowerPoint is both Washington and Adams administrations. So we're going to go 1789 to 1800. It is the last of period three for the AP organization. And I think it's going to work. So let us pause here to double check my... That's what we're going to look at. So Washington's administration, this is what we're going to do in this portion, this episode. some basic elements here that we want to make sure that you know. We're going to look at an essay. Remember, you're practicing the essays, and I'm, giving you study guides and things of that nature. So here's one more essay I'll go over briefly. We're going to look at the overview of Washington. I don't like this color. Then we're going to look at his domestic policies, his executive cabinet, Hamilton's financial plan, report on credit, manufacturers, whiskey rebellion, etc. There's a couple other things like the tariff that we have to make sure you look at and the assumption. So that's this financial plan. That's going to be a big deal. So you got to know that one. All right. So essay one. We did this one. It's about both in intention, in fact, American Revolution conserve. Remember, that's the conservative thesis. We saw that with the revolution. So did the revolution occur to change things or to return things to the way they used to be, to an earlier era? That's a fun one. Revolution, its animating purpose was deeply conservative. This is kind of the same as the last one. Colonials revolted against Britain to keep things the way they were. Is that true? Yes, that's true. Or you can create a different thesis. What is true is, why did they revolt? Was it for some new thing, or was it to conserve it? Anyway, that's a good one. The Declaration of Independence, remember, call for democratic government, equal citizens, which was rejected by writers of the Constitution. Now, this is about equality. It's saying the ideals of the Declaration versus the ideals of the Constitution. So the Declaration of Independence here, what were their values? LERPs, remember? And then, but what's the Constitution do? Does the Constitution, it's limited. LERPs, remember? Because the Constitution supports slavery and it's a republic, which is not the same as democracy. They're limiting the vote. So voting in the Constitution is limited. And so that this question says, the people who wrote the Constitution created an aristocratic government. Is that true? A government run by wealthy or nobles? Is that true? Maybe. That benefit only the wealthy? Did it benefit only the wealthy? Maybe. And so did they have these great concepts in mind, or was it more limiting, or was it mixed? Remember, when you do this, you don't have to go one way or the other. History is complex. So you do a complex thesis. So you remember the three parts, A, B, and C. You could say, A, we had values of LERPs, like liberty, equality, rights, and popular sovereignty based on the Declaration of Independence, that those values are true in America. And then B, you could argue that the Constitution supports that. And then you could argue C, that they also are discriminatory for wealthy people, that they did give the wealthy more privileges and rights. They had more rights than Indians and slaves and poor whites and women and all that. So in this way, you can make a thesis that says, yes, some of this is true. A and B are both true, but C is also true. You get it? That we did have these values, and they did write the Constitution, and they did reflect some of this, but it also reflected the other side. And so with this, it means that history is complicated, and it's not just a simple answer. And that's what I want you to think about with these, when you think about the essays. It's a complex explanation. All right, here's a look at a declaration issued, a call for democratic government. We already did that one. Okay, sorry. Essay 4. By 1796, two clearly defined conflicting political philosophies emerged. Okay, there are going to be two. One is going to be the Federalists. And this is the new Federalist post 1789. This is Federalist after the Constitution is adopted. It becomes a political party. So that's one side. And they want a strong federal government. Okay, that's one side. And then the other side is going to be called the Democrat Republicans, number two, the Dem Republicans. And this side is going to be basically say, no, states' rights. Okay, they want states' rights, and they want limited powers of the federal government. Okay, and so these two groups, one and two, emerge. Boom, true statement. The Federalists under Hamilton, the Republicans under Jefferson, which philosophy, now here's your question, which philosophy best represents the ideals of the American Revolution? So again, this is Madison and Jefferson. And up here, it's going to be Hamilton predominantly. Okay. And so what's interesting now is the big question, which one reflects the American Revolution? Which one is the true holder of the American Revolution? And again, your answer for this is your A, B, and C. You're going to say, well, are the which is it? And you could say the Federalists or the Democrat Republicans reflect these elements of the Revolution. And you could say in the Federalists reflect these elements of the Revolution. And so they both reflect. Here's how the Dems do it. Here's how the Feds do it. And then, but you might want to put one more paragraph on, say, but you could say, see, the Democrat Republicans seem to have more connection because one of them has a little bit more. They both have some. And so that's how I would argue this one. And that's called the complex explanation. That the Dems really do hold the Revolution, paragraph one and paragraph two. But then I would throw in the Federalists also have, do hold the elements of the Revolution. Anyway, that's an idea for that. Okay, and then those are the two essays I wanted to discuss. So we're going to start with the overview. This is the overview. Washington's administration, 1789 to 86. He's two terms. One term, second term. He leaves office 1796. He will be known as a Federalist because he will be in favor of a strong Federalist government. And what does he do in his administration? Well, whenever we study a president, you need to look at these two topics, domestic policies and foreign policies. And I always do a chart. You're going to do a chart for a bunch of these presidents, and I'll explain that to you. But you're going to have a heading of Washington, basic information, and then you're going to have domestic and foreign policy. And then you're going to reinforce the details that we are explaining to you so you can know it and be knowledgeable. All right, moving on. So what are the things that you have to know specifically? Washington creates the executive departments, the Secretary of War, Secretary of State, Treasury, Attorney General. That's known as his cabinet, his advisors. And it's important because when he's the first president, he establishes the precedents for how this operates. Big things, you got to know what Assumption is, the bus. The Capitol in Washington, D.C. was part of the political issues of the day. The report on credit, report on manufacturers, Judiciary Act, Whiskey Rebellion, and a farewell address. And then the foreign policy elements, Neutrality Proclamation, Citizen Genet, Jay Treaty, Pinckney Treaty, and the Battle of Fallen Timbers. So this is your study guide for the test on Washington. Make sure that you can understand all of these and remember them. Be sure to ask questions. So let's look at this. First of all, Washington is so popular. Look at this. He is a great, great hero at the time of the Constitution. He is seen as a Greek or Roman deity. This is Romanesque kind of style. By the way, this is in the Smithsonian Institute. I had a chance to go there a few years ago, and this was a picture I took of this glorifying of Washington. Washington, the hero, virtuous. He's totally sincere and trustworthy and honorable. We call it disinterested. He's here for service alone. He didn't want to come out of retirement, but he comes out of retirement for the Constitution. Remember, he goes to the Constitution Convention in Philadelphia, and his prestige gets the Constitution approved. Well, Washington says it's important. We must follow Washington. And think of Washington's attitude. His ideas are preserve independence. Preserve independence. And then he wants no war, foreign wars. His goal, he would, what do we call that? Avoid war at all costs. And then finally, he hates conflict. Reduce the conflict. He reduce political conflict. Political conflict. And that means in America, political parties that are starting. And another big thing that he wants accomplished, and this put a star by this one, strengthen the presidency. Strengthen the presidency. Please get that. He thought, remember, when you look at the Constitution, the first part of the Constitution is Article 1. Article 1 is the largest part of the Constitution. It has the most pages, most details, the most powers. Because Madison wanted the power to lie in the representation of the people versus the president. Because the president is a mixed bag. He's not directly elected by the people necessarily. And so the Article 2 of the Constitution is limited. It doesn't really explain all the powers. And so that's one of the things that Washington does. He has to create the executive branch. He's creating the executive branch. And he does a wonderful job. It's not perfect, but it's still phenomenally good. And you'll see that in the next slide here when we talk about the cabinet. One more thing I want to point out to you is look at the number of states. We're starting to add states here. Kentucky, I think Vermont was created also as time is going on because we have population growth and people are moving. And so, yeah, so things are going well. He wins all the electoral votes pretty much. So Washington's administration, he sets the precedent. You guys know what that term means, to be president. He sets this tone, the model for what a president is supposed to do. Most presidents emulate his leadership and his example. Sorry. Good. I'm making sure I'm recording. They emulate his example. He creates the executive cabinet, which is the executive departments of Secretary of State, Secretary of War, Secretary of Treasury, Attorney General. I want to point out this little video. You know that musical Hamilton by Lin-Manuel Miranda? Well, there's an interview here about George Washington and Hamilton by the guy who wrote the book, that Lin-Manuel Miranda, the guy who worked on Hamilton and all that. It's very interesting. It's an hour long. Watch it if you can. I think it's worth your time if you're interested in this. Meanwhile, Madison in the first part of Washington's administration they were buddies. They break up in the second term, but they worked together. Madison was an ally in the House of Representatives. So he would meet with Jefferson and Hamilton and Randolph, etc., and Washington when they're making their plans. Madison would be there and they would be working together, and you know, Washington say, okay, Madison, what laws do we need passed? Let's get it done, blah, blah, blah. You're my guy in Congress. But that changes when we get to the second administration. So again, 1789 to 92, right? 92, the first administration, Madison is with George Washington. Then they break up. Madison criticized Washington, and Washington never forgave him again. Washington was very sensitive about criticism. And then Madison leaves and goes to the Democrat Republicans in 1792 for the second term. And that's when we have the breakup between the Federalists and the Democrat Republicans on that side. All right, let me go back to this. One thing I want to show you here when we think about the executive cabinet, and this is kind of, if you're ever in charge of your own country or something, this is an idea on how you can organize it. Washington had the executive departments. These were his advisors. These are the guys running the government. So we got war, we got state, we got treasury, we got the attorney general, and am I missing one? No, we don't have, whatever. So they'll be later on, like the post office. Okay, and Washington was here, and he emulated his leadership style on the military as he was a general. And like he did when he's planning the revolution, he would say, all right, what are the ideas? He gets the ideas. How are we gonna do this? And they all give their input. They all tell, what's his name? Washington. Who makes the decision? He's the decider. He takes all the expert advice and then he uses his wisdom and his judgment to make a decision. And that's really what's his style. And again, every president after follows this example, most of them. Unlike the current president, Donald Trump, by the way, this is the date of this recording is July 23rd, 2020. We're in the middle of the pandemic. There's Homeland Security is fighting rioters in Portland, Oregon, for some strange reason. The mayor of Portland doesn't really want them there. But anyway, so there's a lot going on. COVID, pandemic, president's crazy and has dementia. Yeah. So that's a little time capsule for you if anybody in the future sees this. I hope we survive. Anyway, so Washington sets that tone for how leadership. And one of his main lieutenants was Alexander Hamilton. I can't say enough positive things about Alexander Hamilton in terms of things that are so interesting about him. He was an extreme genius and intellectual on the same scale as Madison. He was considered a surrogate son of Washington, like an adopted son. He met Washington during the Revolution. He fought with Washington. He worked with Washington as Washington's adjutant, means his assistant. He knew Washington as well as probably anybody. Hamilton was an advocate for the strong federal constitution. He helps write the Federalist Papers, remember Publius, first Secretary of Treasury. And then he's going to do these things, and you got to pay very close attention to this. The report on manufacture, report on credit, which all this is part of his finance plan, which is very, very important for Washington's administration. The Bank of the United States, the whiskey tax, the tariff. The assumption. He dies in a duel. And then, of course, here's a video about his life in this this musical was produced. So let's look at that for a minute. Oh my God, don't look at that. Okay, good.
Don't be shocked when your history book and all your friends mention him.
Now place your bets as to who that benefits. The very seat of government where Hamilton sits.
Not true.
Ooh, if the shoe fits, wear it.
Welcome to Ms. Mojo, and today we're counting down our picks for the top 10 Hamilton songs. Before we begin, we publish new videos every day, so be sure to subscribe for more great content. For this list, we listened to the cast recording for the billionth time and ranked our choices on a mix of fan favorites and their importance to the overall Hamill narrative. If you don't agree with our ranking, you'd have had to be in the...
Okay, I'm sorry for the commercial here. I saw Hamilton.
Number 10, Alexander Hamilton. And the world's gonna know your
name. What's your name, man? Alexander Hamilton.
The musical's opening number, named for the eponymous Treasury Secretary, was introduced to the world back in 2009. When Lin-Manuel Miranda performed it at the White House Poetry Jam.
There would have been nothing left to do for someone less astute. He would have been dead or destitute without a cent of restitution.
Inspired by a biography on the American figurehead, Miranda started a concept album about someone he thought embodied hip-hop.
Okay, you have to watch the rest of that on your own. I think it's totally cool. So again, he will be killed in a duel with a guy named Aaron Burr, and that's a picture of that in 1803. All right, so Hamilton is going to be a key player in Washington's administration. He's going to be a key advocate. He's going to be a really, really important figure. So you got to know these things about Madison's financial plan: the assumption, the bus, the tariff, the whiskey tax, and the sale of Indian land. Let's see how all this works out. We'll keep going. So the first part is called the assumption. The assumption says that, I mean, let's just go back. The assumption, I'm going to draw it out. The states during the Revolution owed money to England. They were in debt. The problem here is some states paid their debt, like Virginia and South Carolina, but let's say Rhode Island, Massachusetts, and New York owed money to... Sorry, there's police activity. Owed money to England. What would England do if those debts were not paid? Well, they would send Navy over here. Let's change the color. They'd send Navy ships over here to attack and occupy or try to get their money back. So Hamilton, so again, when the Americans are independent, we owed tons of money to England and nobody would loan us money. And Hamilton said, look, we need strong financial health. We need strong financial health to this new government, and that we got to pay these debts. We got to get out of debt. And so he creates a plan to strengthen the finances of the government. And the first part of the plan is called assumption. The federal government, the government for all the states, takes over the debt of all the states. So if Rhode Island owed money, now the federal government would pay it, boom. And New York would owe it, the federal government will pay those debts. That'll create a strong financial program, strengthen the credit of the country, of the government. It'll get rich people to support the government, to strengthen the union. He'll create the bank, the bus. We need a bank to manage all the money, right? And that's going to be a big part of his financial plan. The assumption was very controversial because some states like Virginia did not pay their debt and they felt they were getting cheated. Well, Rhode Island didn't pay their debt and they get free money. That was an issue, but Hamilton planned for it and said, you know, we have to do it. Another controversy here was, you know, how do we interpret the Constitution? Do we interpret strictly or do we interpret it broadly? Well, nowhere in the Constitution does it say that you can create a bank. And so the Democrat Republicans, remember, we're getting two groups that are emerge that were in opposition. The Federalists, who want a strong government. The Dems want a weak central government. They complained about a bus. They said, look, if it's not written in the Constitution, you can't do it. And Alexander Hamilton had to fight for it. He fought in Congress and was persuasive. It's called the Elastic Clause, remember? It says, the Congress has the power to make any law that is necessary. The creating a Bank of the United States is necessary, according to Hamilton. Therefore, it's constitutional and therefore it's legal. We'll talk about that again. But the bus is controversial. The taxes were controversial. We have excise taxes, the tax on whiskey. That will be a way to get money for the federal government to pay those debts. A tariff is a tax on imported goods. That's, again, going to be money for the federal government. Okay, so let's see how this all works. So you have the bus, and then you have taxes. Remember, there's two big taxes. One is excise. For example, we call the whiskey tax is an excise tax. That money goes into the bus. The other tax, the second tax, is a tariff. And that's a tax on imports, okay? On things that you buy from other countries. We're going to go into that later. It's an important tax. That tax goes in the bus. This is the Bank of the United States. And then you get the sale of Indian land. That money goes into the bus. That's about it, right? And so what does the bus do? The bus pays the debts with that money. Okay? And then sometimes to finance all these debts, they need to borrow money. And so what happens is we get money going in to the bus, and then we get money going out and spending, etc. Okay? Moving on. We're continuing. So again, tax on imported goods, make sure you know that. Excise tax on whiskey. Whiskey is going to be a big problem for some people, and they're going to rebel against George Washington. And we'll see that in the Whiskey Rebellion. So again, look, there's two things. The report on credit. And what's significant here is it's about the credit of the new U.S. government, right? Under the Constitution. And so what do you think? This is Hamilton's report. What do you think this report's going to say? It's going to say, well, the government of the United States should have good credit. That's what it's going to say. And he's going to say why we need it. How are we going to get it? The assumption. And then the taxes, which is the whiskey tax and the tariff. Okay. And then lastly, the sale of Indian land. And then guess what else? The bus. Okay. So those are all parts of the plan. And that's going to be in that report. And then also, the report on manufacturers. Guess what that's going to say? It's going to say, we need to develop industry in America. And how? With the tariff will help. So that's two references on the tariff. One to help our industry, and the other is just a revenue tariff. Do you follow? Anyway, so that's the big picture. And make sure you know that part of Hamilton's economic plan included these reports that justified his plan. That's it. Easy. Okay, the Whiskey Rebellion quickly. Because of Hamilton's financial plan, the whiskey tax, farmers protest about the tax. And Washington goes to confront them. He marches out. He puts on his uniform. And he says, you cannot always jump up against the government. The government is here. If you want to change it, you have to vote. Do you get it? And so he asserts the power of the federal government. He says, we're not going to have continuous Shays rebellions or whiskey rebellions or any rebellions. You're going to be loyal to the government of the United States. And lastly, for domestic policies under Washington's administration, we get the Judiciary Act. All that does is establishes the federal courts. That's all you need to know. But in 1800, it's going to be a big issue in a Supreme Court case. In 1800, so we got to pay attention to the Judiciary Act. It says, organize federal courts, establish the Attorney General, and again, courts will have the power to interpret the Constitution. Big idea. And interpret means to judge, right? You know that. All right, let's move on. And we finished part one of Washington's admin. Let's see. This was a long one. Sorry for the... But we had to go through most of it. That's very, very important. We'll see you next time, and we're going to finish Foreign Policy of Washington. Okay. See you later.